Hello, everybody, and welcome to Wicklow Screendance Laboratory 2024. We're delighted to be with you again on our online screening session, the first of two. I'd like to say that we're operating from Bray in County Wicklow, which is a small town just south of Dublin on the east coast of Ireland, and we're being streamed live through London and being streamed worldwide. So welcome to all our local and international. You're very welcome, and we're delighted to have a great programme lined up for you tonight. I'd like to take the opportunity to say that my name is Adrienne Brown. I'm the founder and artistic director of the festival. It's 8 years running this year. We're also at a point of change during the year to come. We will be renaming the festival, but for now, we're proud to go under the banner of Wicklow Screendance Laboratory. I would like to give thanks to the following organisations and people who have kept us in business and made it possible for us to have this festival. So big thanks to the Arts Council of Ireland, to Wicklow Arts Office, to Wicklow Community Support Fund, to Spotlight Dance Studios, Inchicore College of Further Education, Dublin South City Partnership, and Dublin City Council. I'd like to thank our partners, Mermaid Arts Centre, the College of Dance, Inchicore College of Further Education, Dance Ireland, and Spotlight Dance Studios. And I also want to give a big thanks to the team that have helped me and are working with me closely for the last year or two, and that includes producer Kerry Posovitz, communications and socials manager Sarah Eva Manson, operations manager Hannah Slattery, website management from Christian Daly, technical manager Rory O'Sullivan, and digital production and streaming from Curtis Rodney. So tonight we have a programme of films that have come through our platform Film Freeway when we send out an invitation for submission of films. And this art form of what can be called dance on film or video dance or screen dance, or it has many, many nomenclatures, but for now we can just say that it is a beautiful hybrid form of one of the arts of dance and expression through the movement of the body. So for tonight's panel, first of all, I'd like to welcome and introduce, we have Siobhán Daffy. And Siobhán lives in the Dublin Mountains in Ireland. She's an author, a poet, and a lover of creative fire. Her CD, Horses Hooves, I beg your pardon, I'll read that again. Her CD, Horses Hooves, a music and poetry collaboration, was released in 2016. Her first children's novel, No Ordinary Joe, was published with Little Island Books in 2021. She is currently working on a non-fiction project. Siobhán has worked as a facilitator of the creative arts for over 20 years and also runs a natural health practice focused on women's well-being. So welcome, Siobhán. Lovely to see you here. And I would also like to say that we have moderating the chat. We have an open chat line, and please feel free to make any kind of observations or comments or say hello and tell us where you're calling in from. But moderating and manning that system is the wonderful Sarah Eve. Sarah might like to come on and say hi.
Yeah, I'll be in the chat there with you all this evening. So do get involved and ask us all questions. I'll be able to feed our wonderful panelists all your questions, and that would be really great for you to do.
Thank you very much, Sarah. And Sarah really is one of the very public faces of the festival by narrating and curating and putting the images out on social media. And I'm very grateful for that work. Thank you so much. So I think perhaps we might get into our first film. So we will speak to you again in a short while.
Thank you. Thank you. Who am I? I'm sentenced to prejudice. Judge, being judged. Everybody does. And who am I? I am different. They have no right. They have no right. They have no right. I'm determined to control my identity, to fight for identity, to fight for equality, to fight for identity. I fight for equality. That's who I am. inclusion, judge, to fight for identity, to fight for equality, to fight for identity. I fight for equality. I fight. We are scared for the unknown, so we judge. The way I see things and the way you see things are not the same. Is my experience decisive? Everybody controls his own identity. Everybody makes his own choices. We can only sentence ourselves. We are more than labels. And we are more than words. So, who are you? Thank you.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping, and the vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound of silence. In restless dreams I walked alone, streets of cobblestone, neath the halo of a street lamp, I turned my collar to the cold and damp. When my eyes were stunned by the flash of a neon light that split the night, touch the sound of silence. And in the naked light I saw 10,000 people, maybe more. People talking without speaking, people hearing.
Raindrops
of silence.
Thank you.
So, Sarah, would you like to tell people where they can find the running order for tonight's films?
Yes, absolutely. So if you pop over to our website, screendance.ie, on the homepage, there's a button that says View Programme, and there you'll be able to download the PDF, and tonight's running order is on page 6.
Thanks very much, Sarah. So delighted to see we have a very lively chat group, and I'd like to make a couple of hellos and welcomes to people in the chat. So we have here with us Petra Cuppers, and she's in France at the moment. Thank you, Petra. She's made some really fabulous points along the way. And her film will be a little bit later. It's Touching Time, and it's quite a long title. We'll come to that in due course. And then we have Patrick Carelsz also, and his film was the second film, Blinkered, that we just saw a moment ago. Then we have Kelly Hargreaves, who has two films in tonight, both going to be later in the programme. One is Mine, and the other one is What It Feels Like. And we also have Terence White. We have two films from him in this festival. Tonight we're showing Fling. It was the first film. And on Thursday evening, we'll be showing his other film in this festival, Waves. Thank you, and a big hello to Deirdre Grant, who I know made a comment in the chat, in the YouTube chat. She is in the film Waves, and I know Deirdre for many years. Great comments here from Petra about, yes, she asked about having a running order. So we've just given some instructions about that, how you can find that. Yes, indeed, the first two pieces, one after the other, having very different and gorgeous birds for connection. Yes, that's a lovely point, Petra. Yes, and the use of sight, as Petra also was commenting, the filming sites have their own power and influence on the movement work. Yeah, we'll be definitely looking at that, and I completely agree. And likewise, that last film we saw, Upwell, with the single dancer, and the sense of how water and movement and community are depicted in that film. Yeah, great comments. And please feel free, anybody who wants to put in any kind of commentary on any of the films that they're seeing. So, Siobhán, let's have a chat about what we've just seen. Have you any thoughts?
What a pleasure.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a delight. What an amazing array of work. And so, yeah, visually stimulating and exciting, really. This wouldn't be a form I'm familiar with, so it's fabulous to be introduced like this, and just to, you know, to have the opportunity to look at work like this and see this art form in action. Yeah, just to see the, you know, it's like watching a stage, but it's taking place in film, and that lovely, you know, movement of the place and the body and how it's being expressed. I just find it extraordinary. So yeah, there's a great array of of films there. So it's special, of course, with the Irish one to see it as well set in Dunleary, and to see the use of the sea and the different. I loved how they used what was available, like the benches and the telescopes, and to watch them interacting with those things. That's very exciting.
That was the first film, Fling, from Terence White. Yes.
Yeah.
And I would also kind of add that there's great narrative and storytelling in this film as well, and done without obvious mime, but just very clever duets and interactions that are done through dance and movement. Yeah, it's really well done, very well handled, I think, as well.
Very clever,
quirky. Yeah.
Very quirky. Even just like, and I love that movement where they just put what, you know, the head on the shoulder, the head on the shoulder.
Yeah.
It's sort of exploring human dynamics in a very visual way, where a lot of that often happens in ways that we don't see it, but it's happening. And, you know, it's lovely to see it brought into it with such lightness. It's so humorous. And I felt the music really added to the humor and gave it, like, from the get-go, you sort of had this feeling of, well, this is fun and this is light and this is enjoyable. And, do you know, even though it's exploring something that for a young person who's stuck in those dynamics can be really, you know, distressing. But there was just a feeling of looking at it in such a humorous way as well, you know.
Yeah. And one of the dancers in that film, Ali White, she's actually on the program performing. She's dancing in the festival. In fact, she'll be on A Mermaid on Thursday. But you're quite right. And I just wanted to make a comment back to what you said about being new to this art form, Siobhán. It's wonderful that somebody comes new to an art form with their own artistic background. And there's something we were talking, we have a kind of a virtual green room here on the live stream. So we were chatting a little bit amongst Siobhán and I, amongst ourselves. And we were commenting about how this art form of dance on film or video dance or screen dance, really, it is so very open to so many different interpretations. And as Petra was saying, the kind of the use of site-specific areas that can really contribute to the films themselves. Not to forget about the film techniques and filmmaking techniques, which are really, you know, I would say, for example, a film like Flight, while it's like all good art, it looks easy, but there was a lot of work in the background, I'm sure.
Yeah,
we both were aware of that. Do you have any other comments on what about Blinkered, Siobhán? Do you have anything on that?
Yeah, really interesting. Sort of interesting how we're working with the voiceover and the, you know, the movement and the kind of the physical presence of like labels and how we label and, you know, and the movement was quite vigorous. Like, I really enjoyed those sequences with the, you know, especially when with the duet and the two, you know, these kinds of movements and pushing off each other, and didn't she jump up on his back and all this kind of stuff. It's so physical. I really enjoyed the physicality of that, and just, I suppose, trashing things out and going around to the different people, like, and looking at the labels individually that we give people and how we label ourselves. And it's very interesting, you know, it's interesting to see what people choose to explore in that.
Yes. Film, yeah. I think that's a great comment about thrashing things out. Yeah. So when we see this kind of vigorous movement, because movement in its own way is it's a language and is conveying something in the same way as words or music or anything, but you don't have to be versed in the language of dance to really feel the physicality and the kind of those sort of moments where there's a bit of a coming together antagonistically. One of the things I loved in the film, really appreciated, was the light and the I wasn't sure if it was a stage set or an actual street scene. I think it was a street scene, but there was something about the way the lighting was done and the way the colors were and the skin tone that gave it a beautiful theatrical, slightly otherworldly. It was both in a physical real space, but seemed to be somehow modified or something.
Absolutely. Yeah, no, I thought that was very well done as well. It gave it a kind of a starkness as well, that you were only looking at that and you were immersed in it, but at the same time there weren't distractions in it. It was very
It was an empty street. There were no
presence,
distractions. Definitely. Yeah, I agree. I think we both loved School Birds quite a lot.
Yeah.
Yes. Great film, isn't it?
Yeah, great. Yeah. It was interesting because you don't know what to expect. I like that setting where you're just in this classroom and it has everything, like even whatever, you know, the purple line or the, I forget, I remember noticing it's like I've been in children's classrooms and it's like,
yeah.
Okay. And to have that taking place there was so great, like to use
Yeah.
the space in that way. I just adored the movement in that. I just thought it was fabulous. Yeah.
Yes, it was. And it's a great, a very brave commitment to movement, I felt, on the part of the person who played the teacher. You know, we had the janitor and the teacher, essentially.
Yeah.
And I found that the movement quality and the, what was, it was brave to be a bird. You know, it's not everybody that can carry that off. And it was done with a sort of a naive bravery, I felt. And but very, very, I mean, the tenderness when the janitor touched him on the cheek, there was a lot of emotional tenderness in there too. I thought it was very moving.
It was, yeah. It was
very
a very
moving.
Real intimacy. And you're nearly,
yes,
like, oh, is that about physical intimacy? And it's like, this is about soul intimacy. Like, this is like he's, do you
yes
know, it's like,
yeah,
really reaching into such a deeper place, I felt,
yeah,
watching it. Like, and that was really enjoyable because it was so well expressed.
Yes, yeah,
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yes, it was a real soul intimacy. And yeah, it was a very tightly constructed piece as well, I think. There was not too much of anything. It was just those moments where it built up to that moment of connection. And I did love that film. Sorry, repeating myself a lot here. What do you think about our other films? We had Sound of Silence and Upwell.
Yeah.
Ah, I just say Patrick Carelsz has just said that it was staged. Ah, they added the light to stress out the scene. The street was real. Okay.
Yeah,
So it was
really
both
interesting.
Staged and on a street. Thank you, Patrick. That's really helpful. Great. And yeah, what do you think about those other films?
The
how
Sound
did
of
you
Silence.
respond to them, rather?
Yeah, very, I mean, the music, like, and to be working at that level. I loved the setting. I loved the white, you know, dress, all the visual, that had so much visual going on, like with
Yes.
the music and the movement. And
Yeah.
then, you know, all these other people appearing and their movement with their clothes, like these cloaks, like they create really interesting kind of structural shapes, I thought, in the space.
Yes.
And then you've got this like quite industrial, or wasn't even industrial, but it was like a cell, kind of, you know, this darkness that you're like, what, you know, what's happening? Like, what's the story with this? Like,
yes,
you know, it was very kind of evocative, and there's so much going on in it, wasn't there?
There was, yes, definitely. And I really felt that the power of the movement, the choreography, the dancers and the music and the set, it very much was those three parts, if you like, which felt very equally
Yes.
Engaging. They were both, all three parts were very rich, the music, the set and the movement, very richly kind of collaborating with each other. Yes, it's a beautiful film, and I think it works very, it's you carried along with it somehow. It's lovely. And also I would say the performances from the dancers, I kind of know a little bit about who the filmmaker and the people involved. These are young people who are, you know, a lot of commitment, maturity in their performances, I thought.
Oh yeah,
Yeah.
amazing. That's really interesting. Yeah, I
yeah.
mean, it's very atmospheric, and it had a lovely
Yes.
grittiness about it, like, as well. I like that. Really textured.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm.
And then what about Upwell?
Oh, I just love that so much, like the water. I was saying to you earlier, we were talking that, yeah, I just wanted to like get into water, and there was so much about it that I really loved. I loved the sequences and the that synchronized movement with the surf. I loved the water moving with the music, with the dance, and then the scenes of the body, you know, the woman moving on her own, like with so much physicality and strength. And I found it really moving, actually. And I loved that. It's funny, I made a note of the quote. I'll be able to read it now. I have something on it. And in Me Too, the wave rises, Virginia Woolf
Oh.
at the end. And I had this
Oh,
real
yes.
sense of, yeah, like what, that it's some kind of a dedication, or like what was it about, and who, what was the dedication? There was something really special in it, I felt. And the water, there was such a depth in it, like I could
Yes.
feel this emotional depth, you know, that I felt like I don't know the whole story, but I know there's something really moving in this that's being expressed, and I'm curious to know more about it as
Yeah.
a
Well, I'm going to enlighten you a little bit. I know the filmmaker Jamie Morrison, and she, in fact, many years ago spent some time in Dublin and danced in some of my pieces of choreography, but that's sort of a side note. But when I saw the film coming in from her, I had a very similar reaction to you. And same by the comments about just the beauty of this woman, you know, and the vulnerability and the her movement quality was so extraordinary. But what I can say is that Jamie herself works in grief, counselling grief work. She does a lot of work around grief. And I don't have the notes in front of me about what the film is about, but I do know that she and I have exchanged a few emails. In fact, she's going to be at the festival on Thursday in Ireland. So it'd be wonderful to see her again. But yeah, she talked about that the woman, or I don't know if it's the woman herself or whether she represents somebody, but it's about somebody who's coming from a loss. They have lost a loved one, and they are trying to take action. And I'm not sure if the actual surfing is part of it. It may very well be. I can't fill in that part of the story, but it's definitely somebody having gone through a grief experience, and that they're trying to kind of find the ability to push through into back into life perhaps. But I think that really comes across so strongly in this work.
No, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, that's really interesting, because I found myself thinking, who is it dedicated to? Who's making, that was my question. I thought, that makes a lot of sense, you know. Yes. And it's very there. I love that. I love that, like, you don't know, but you can feel it.
Exactly. You know? Yeah. Yes, exactly. Yeah. Beautiful. Yeah. I think those opening sequence of the dancer lying in the on the wave, and just at the camera work again, getting up so close. And that's one of the things I've noticed this year in particular, is certain times when people use the camera, that it might be up against the fabric, as we'll see in one of Kelly Hargreaves' films in a little while, that there's something about this viewpoint that brings us into places that we don't see when we're watching something from a distance on stage. And I was really aware of that with I was very aware of the woman's beauty in a sort of transcendental way. She was both beautiful as a woman, but also evocative of some other kind of soulful beauty. It was lovely. Yeah.
Wonderful. Yeah. And the music actually was beautiful. Yes. That as well. Yeah, and the music and the catching of, say, water drops even up close.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Really beautiful.
It's such a gift, really, this kind of work that's being created, and then that we can receive it and share it. And
it's so sensual. I love how sensual it is. Yeah.
It really is. Yeah. Without being gratuitous. So perhaps we'll go into our next, we're going to look at a few more films now. Programme can be found on the website screendance.ie, and we'll return again to talk in a short while.
In the beginning is how it all started. That is how the Bible begins. Bereshit in Hebrew. The question is, what about the end? Very frightening to think about the end. How does it all end? Does it all end? Why does it all end? The Bible was written thousands and thousands and thousands of years ago. God gave it to Moses. But there's an oral Bible that came along with the written Bible, and that's called the Midrash. The oral Bible was written down 2,000 years ago, and the oral Bible discusses the end, and it's a great warning, and it is written in the Midrash. When God created the first man, He took him and showed him all the trees of the Garden of Eden and said to him, "See my works, how beautiful and praiseworthy they are. And everything that I created it for you. Be careful not to spoil or destroy my world, for if you do, there will be nobody after you to repair it." We are all from planet Earth, all different colors, religions, nationalities, we're all one big family. God has given us a great warning about the ending. We have now all over the planet, destroyed the water, destroyed the air, and we have now created weapons of mass destruction. We have a chance to change the ending. We have free will. We can clean up the waters. We could clean up the air, and we could destroy the weapons of mass destruction. We still have a chance. There is no way in the world that this could have been written 2,000 years ago. There's no way anybody would have known about water pollution or air pollution, and certainly not weapons of mass destruction. They had natural disasters like hurricanes and earthquakes that were natural, but mankind did not have the power to destroy the world. God warned Adam, and now, as we stand here today, we have the ability. Thousands of years ago, nobody would have even understood if somebody said, don't destroy the earth or the air or the water. It's like telling somebody not to use their cell phone too much. 500 years ago, nobody would understand. So this is a warning from God. This is divine information. This is a direct message from God to mankind. The world leaders need to pay attention to this message. World leaders are not spiritual leaders. They're not Moses. They're not Abraham. They're not Isaac. They're not Jacob. They're not any of the spiritual leaders appointed by God. But we as mankind need to come together and stop the destruction of the earth. The end is almost near, but we have the power to stop it. It is written in the beginning, and we are given a warning in the Midrash for the end. So let us come together as the children of God, as one big family, to help each other, to love each other, and to save this beautiful planet so the end is not here and we can continue on for the children and the grandchildren and the grandchildren of the next generation. We are the only ones that have this power. The message has been given to us. Amen.
Oh,
So thank you everybody for such a really engaged and lively chat. The chat room today is really full of wonderful and interesting commentary. Has anything struck you in these comments, Siobhán? Anything you wanted to speak about?
Yeah, I'm just very interested. I'm looking at one here now from Mary Steadman in relation to, is it pronounced Sandra? That's, I don't know if that's the correct pronunciation, but that I think that was the second one about the landscape, talking about a very visceral sense of place, body, and grey stone dust on body. I love that very much about the human struggle and the interaction with the landscape, and then the changes and the going from the very bereft landscape to the more, you know, lush and with the water and everything. And the comment is talking about embodying strength and the vulnerability of dry, dying land. Beautiful. Loved the water hope. Yeah, so it's interesting that person is picking up. Yeah, and you know, the when the dancer is more going through the water and the water is splashing up and it's, you know, it's so alive. And then the contrast with the struggle and the, you know, trying to get up through the shale, that shaley grey rock. It's a really interesting interaction with the landscape. And that seems to be a theme. Of course, this section has that ecology and activism theme, but it's a lot of really interesting interaction with the physical landscape and these outdoor spaces.
Yes, absolutely. I'm very conscious too in that, just as a kind of a dancer, when I was younger, I was a dancer, but just it's so hard to dance in that kind of gritty, gravelly kind of shale. It's very hard in the body. So I'm very aware of that. There's some beautiful editing too in that, where very fast, sudden editing changes, where about two thirds of the way through, where it really starts to get come to a kind of climax. And yes, that and the earlier film too, the message, which was also related to the idea of the ecology and the sense of urgency around the ecology and about the earth and damage to the earth, I would feel, yeah.
Yeah, and I suppose our interaction with place or how it reflects like us and we're part of it and it's part of us. And, you know, I'm thinking as well of that one, then Dreaming of Rare Moments with the longer title. That's just the first part of the title there with the in the wasteland with the wires and the train land and all those industrial buildings and the person in the boiler suit dancing. I just found that extraordinarily evocative and just reminding me of all those wasteland places and weed places where, you know, in ourselves and in our landscapes, like the disused spaces. And I suppose it's so close to kind of regeneration and wildness, but it's got this industrial feel. And is it what we've done to the landscape, or is the landscape reclaiming itself, or like all those kind of in between spaces? Is, you know, and watching a person interact who's wearing a boiler suit in that very, you know, the work person, like and the industrial person, and then there's our wild nature or in the weeds, you know, there's just so much going on there, isn't there, in the interaction with the landscape.
Yes, I agree. And I think that comes across very strongly in in the films this year, actually. There are many films that have a really visceral, almost just at the surface of the skin, you feel the world. The world is right there with the mover, the dancer, and in whatever way they're interacting with it. It's really amazing. And it's something that we can't really show in performance on stage quite so much. Yeah, there were a couple of films that I was really, well, I love all of them actually, but just there were African-American themes in What's Bred in Blood and Bone and also OTW to Freedom. Both of them really addressing some of the issues to do with the first, in the case of What's Bred in Blood and Bone, about a period where the lynchings were taking place very strongly and a sense of recovering the place and recovering their entitlement to space. And I felt with that film actually that while there were three dancers, they were very individual and appeared separate. And yet, even when they were dancing as a trio, there was a sense of separation I was quite conscious about. Beautifully done. I don't know if it was intentional. And as you say, dreaming of place as well. How did you feel about the films in that second group? Or what struck you? What is it that is calling to be said?
Good question. Yeah, that theme of, I suppose, the place and then the activism. I found that very striking as well, watching those dancers, and in the Freedom one as well, the OTW Freedom, just the amazing, I suppose, and it really made me think about like what it is to be oppressed and what it is to be suppressed and how much that film, like, or that short film was just the complete opposite of that. And it was just amazing to watch that. There was such liberation in the movement. And then this contrast between the maybe classical sort of dance moves and these maybe traditional African moves, and just very free movement, just of a person in complete flow. It's just amazing to watch, isn't it? It's very moving as well to think of what is the opposite. You know, oppression is the opposite to that, and suppression. And it's just so sad to think. Imagine taking that and putting it in a bottle. Like, it's just it's devastating, isn't it? And or putting it in a cage, putting it in, you know, you can't do that. You can't move like that. You can't behave like that. You can't be yourself. Like to experience the contrast to that, it's liberating for everybody. I think you feel liberated inside when you watch that. It invites everybody to feel free, doesn't it?
Yes. I agree completely. And also, I'm very aware of this dancer in this film having the most extraordinary body, the kind of body that is just a joy to watch, you know, like the kind of visceral feeling of her power as a mover. So while it's, and I know from the notes about the film that it's very much about the mental health effect of people feeling obliged to switch codes in order to fit in to a society that they feel they don't belong, or they can't, as you say, express their full, complete identity in a natural way that's natural to them. But allied with that is this powerful performance from this dancer, who is actually outstripping and far surpassing any of the codes she's talking about, really. There's that slight kind of interesting dilemma for me, because but that's the great mystery of art. You know, as artists, we set out to do something or create something, but often it takes a different journey and it ends up being, you kind of think, oh, so that's what I did. I didn't really intend, or didn't know that was going to happen. So no, I'm not diminishing in any way the intention or the film itself slightly, but just I find it, also in that film, I wanted to say, I loved the use of split screen, which came about. So it gives this lovely design element where you sometimes see things like boxes within boxes on the main screen, and where it went to black and white on occasion. So there's a lot of use of design elements that really enhance it as well. Beautifully filmed. And the people in the background and the in the park just kind of having a picnic and reading a book and not being aware of this thing being enacted in front of them. Yeah. Any other thoughts or comments regarding?
Yeah, well, I'm back. I'm thinking of the landscape now again. I mean, it must be so difficult. I'm just thinking of what you were saying about that moving in the shale as well, like that person in the park, and then the guy, like, you know, on the side of the mountain, and at the end there, the person in that what looked that very rural, is it a Scottish landscape?
Yes.
Yeah, it's so you know, because I suppose the body kind of changes as well, and some of them the body seems very influenced by the environment and kind of moving into it, and in others yeah. it's like that body would be free in any environment, mm-hmm. moving the way it's mm-hmm. moving, or do you know, there's yeah. such different relationships with yeah. And I suppose yes. that's yeah a reflection yeah. of all of our interactions.
Yes, I loved that film, Mine. And it really brought up, evoked feelings of ownership and belonging and reclaiming or claiming and ownership and belonging. And I'm just, I'm very interested in Kelly having these two films, and we're going to see another one in a while. But something about, there's a certain simplicity of her approach, I feel, as in this man is interacting with this beautiful landscape, and times he's going into the rock, at times he's on, you know, he's emerging from the landscape in some way, but he's very much at one with the landscape. Mm-hmm. That's why I feel that sense of belonging. And I'll just put a pause on that for now, because I might want to come back if I hope I remember when we get to the second film. Yeah, it's really good stuff. So shall we move into our next section of films?
Mm-hmm.
Let's do that.
Video audio description. A group of disabled dance artists meet on Minnehanak, Roosevelt Island, a historical site of hospitals, mental asylums, and prisons. They dance, happy to be in each other's company and in the shadows of people who hadn't chosen to be here, swirling dates and milestones through their body-mind spirits. They move with and alongside nature, sculpture, community, and the past. Touching Time, Minnehanak, Roosevelt Island.
Thank you. 1832, the penitentiary opens, built from stone quarried on the island. 1839, New York City Asylum for the Insane opens.
1856, smallpox hospital built with convict labor.
1861, charity hospital built with convict labor.
1869, the workhouse opens.
1894, first known United States polio epidemic occurs in Vermont.
1940, FDR reelected.
41 to 45, FDR leads the United States during World War II.
1945, the United Nations envisioned by FDR opens.
1952, polio cases reported in the United States peak at over 57,000.
1953, Dr. Jonas Salk develops polio vaccine at the University of Michigan and announces it at the Rackham Building. Oh,
join community in apartments designed for those physically disabled. 1990, Americans with Disabilities Act becomes law.
Woo! 2012, FDR Four Freedoms Park opens at the southern tip of Roosevelt Island. 2013, Goldwater Hospital decommissioned and demolished.
Touching Time, Minnehanak, Roosevelt Island. Direction, Petra Cuppers. Camera, edit, sound, Kim McDaniel. Performers, Amy Ackerman, Stephanie Height, Desiree Molly Moobanks, Mikkel Molly Moobanks, Petra Cuppers, Marina Heron Sablina, and Moira Williams. Thank you to the Disability History Handbook Project, the National Park Service, the National Council on Public History, the Speculative Embodiment Working Group, University of Michigan Arts Initiative, the University of Utah Professional Development Fund, the Dance USA Fellowship. In Olympia's Disability Culture Production, 2023.
Yeah, I thought also at one point I put myself on the floor in the middle of the street, and I found it very interesting, that moment for me, because I really felt like what you're all talking about, the power of the group, because even though in a way it's a more vulnerable position, especially because there's people walking down the street, I didn't feel vulnerable at all, because I felt part of the group, you know, and I felt really like powerful even there in my more vulnerable position, I'd say. So that's, yeah, I think it wouldn't be possible if we didn't have all this, what we're talking about. So yeah, that's interesting.
Thank you.
Like, I'm gonna carry it, I guess, because it's very strong. And I feel it a lot when I walk, again, it's not so much because it is like about female or male, it's just this wildness.
Thank you. Do you Dida, what it done, oh, what done it done, da 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 da, what da 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 da, what da 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 da.
So I just need to make a small announcement about one of the films, which was City Horses. And just to say that that is a prequel or a trailer of an installation, which is a much longer piece and takes up to about 100 minutes, I believe. We're hoping to have it featured in its fullness in the festival next year. But I just wanted to make it clear that that's a trailer, not the full film. So, Siobhán, over to you. What have you been noticing in this section?
I've been really enjoying these. They're so great. That's such a very dramatic note to finish on with the last one. roller coaster ride. Yeah, really enjoying them all, the contrast and the contrast in the films, the different scenes, and then the contrast between the different ones themselves. And I could identify as well, having worked in community arts a long time, with the movie Touching Time, in terms of just really watching people reclaim the space and going into a space like that and working like that physically with people in the wheelchairs, and looking at disability and the themes around the institutionalization. I found that very moving. And because I had a sense of, I suppose, having worked in that area, what it's like to be part of that process. And you could really feel the community and the connection between the people and the work they'd done together. So I found that really moving. Mm. And then
can I just say something, not to disrupt your flow, but I completely agree. And Mary Steadman has a lovely comment about it, talking about the choreography, the humanity contrasts with the shock of the history. And she comments on the camera shots and the fluid sense of rhythm. But also I wanted to just say too, that there's the danger of falling into sympathy. You know, the danger of being sort of, oh, well, this is about people with other abilities, and therefore it evokes sympathy. But I think you're looking at something different here, aren't you, Siobhán?
Yeah, absolutely. Because what you really see is just the presence, like, that they're occupying in that space, and their, you know, their freedom at being able to, you know, visit there and evoke that history and speak to it, you know, with their community and the light, like, that comes in it, you know.
Yeah,
it's fantastic.
Yes, I agree. I felt that there was something while the narration of the history of institutions that dealt with different kinds of illness, and polio was mentioned quite a lot, but that they were almost able to, how can I put this now, not laugh at it, but they were able to be with it in a way that wasn't tragic or something. I don't know what I'm saying really, but maybe it came from their experience of their life that meant that their coming together in this way was different to perhaps how I might respond to those kind of issues. I don't know. I'm not making
a very strong very point true. I hear what you're saying. Yeah, because it's a heavy, because that's quite a heavy history, but there was not a heaviness in that.
That's exactly what I meant. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, they had a lovely lightness, a lovely presence. Yeah. Like,
Yes.
I think that came out of their connection with each other. For me, it was just a lovely physical connection and intimacy, and that kind of overrode all of that. So you didn't feel that heaviness. Yeah.
Yeah, indeed. And you and I were talking about this while we were watching the film, about how in many cases with this kind of work and the work you have done, it's about the process, and it's not about producing a product really.
It's about the connection, what people are experiencing. And I suppose you can feel the experience that they were having. And then that becomes something very heartfelt in its own right.
Yes,
you know?
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And some very beautiful moving parts in it too, like the movement, I recall, of the beautiful woman in a long blue coat, I think, with a kind of a purple scarf. She was doing something so incredibly... she was very much embodying a very beautiful sense of the dancer, I felt, in one or two parts. Really noticed her. She was lovely.
Yeah. I love those movements of the hands as well.
And yes.
There was a voice. Exactly. And talking about waves and the sea.
Yes.
And
there was a lovely scene where one of it may have even been Petra, on a scooter, goes around this circular part. There's a wall. And another one of the women just reaches out and does a sweep as she passes. It's just a little moment, but it's kind of like percussive with the music or something. It has that effect on me. So yes, it was really gorgeous. Just seeing as, oh yes, indeed. Yes, many of the performers have personal experiences of the site or related sites. One of the performers' mother was a polio baby. Yes, okay, thank you very much, Petra. Yeah, that makes it even more. So it's very much about a real embodied lived experience and memory. Great. Thank you. Yes. Oh, my goodness. And So moving on then to the next section, I'm sort of in love with all of the films, really, really feeling them in a big way. What I want to say about City Horses is that I just love this film. I want to be one of those women doing that, being a horse in Sweden, where that, in Stockholm, I think it was. And I'm looking forward to seeing the film next year. And if we have any of the artists involved who may see this in the coming months, because we leave these links up live, we often get a lot of audience after the festival finishes. But I just want to say I love the commitment of the movers to what they were doing. And I love that performance art that takes place in an urban setting in a busy street or something. I find that, yeah, just gorgeous. It's like when you're walking around doing your shopping and suddenly it's happening. Yeah.
Yeah. The wildness, their movement is amazing, isn't it?
Yes.
Like, they really do look like horses, like
exactly.
In space.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. It was that.
Untamed nature. Yeah.
Untamed. And they really embodied the spirit of Equus, you know, the horse. They were not just trying to be horse-like. It seemed that they were,
yes, exactly, yeah,
in a horse universe or something. It's really fantastic. And also it's just even seeing them, you know, lying on the ground on a wet street, by the way, not a dry street, so it's a little uncomfortable there too, but there they are, committed to the last moment. Yes, anything else you wanted to say about any of those films?
There's a lovely comment about the two worlds colliding in the magnificent sameness piece, yes, which was so extraordinary presence, and talking about strength and softness and the push and pull of two worlds. I mean, that was amazing to watch, wasn't it? That kind of almost apocalyptic world with the grayness and the clothes and the movement, and how I love that with the shapes, the long lines of the building and the body moving against the building and the body moving against concrete. That was just so arresting to watch, wasn't it? And then the contrast with the red dress and the red lipstick and the green field, and oh, it was just an amazing expression. So it really brought to life those two contrasting kind of places that you can find yourself, didn't it?
Yes, I agree completely. I want to say that I can relate to those two women, or those two aspects of that woman, so strongly. You know, the feeling of stuckness, the feeling of being in your grey. And I really loved how she moved so slowly in this kind of, in wherever it was, on a street alongside the house or the building, or on the little small wall that was in front of it. It was the pace, and it was the movement, and it was the emptiness of the streets too. I'm noticing that in some of these films. And then when she took that ages and ages to take that step, you know, off the sidewalk, and she's kind of hovering. And then it's like, as you said, we were all there with her, taking that step with her. Yeah. And then suddenly she's instantly she's running, or she's moving maybe at that point, and suddenly she's in red. And I felt I'm very conscious of the color, the power of red. It's one of the colors I really respond to. I love it. It's such a primal color, and it's such a primal, it's both the blood, the power, the passion, but it's kind of an element of danger in there as well. And I could even sense that in how she used her makeup around her eyes. But there was such beauty in her, and such beauty in this woman. And I just feel that that's a film that stays with me. I have to reflect on it a lot.
Yeah, absolutely. And the red is so striking, and it's so interesting, because it is a very earthy, groundy color in some ways. And in other ways, like, I was looking at her lipstick and saying, it's interesting, she's in the landscape and she's so wild and free, but she also looks like she could be going to a very sort of, you know, demanding business meeting or heading out for the night. Do you know the way she's dressed? And I love that, because it was the wild nature in the nature, and just all of it worked. It was such a wonderful choice of color, and the whole expression of it in the green. The green looked so vibrant then against the red, and they've made such interesting color choices and kind of location choices with that. I thought it was so beautifully done.
I've been thinking a bit about how, with filmmaking, I'm not saying this as an expert, just observing, that sometimes it's knowing how you want to control the eventual image. I suppose having a plotting storyboard where you kind of know where you're going with it, that can really make the difference in films, I feel, that there's something... I feel with this filmmaker that this that they really had thought through the colors, the movements, the tempo, and every detail. And also, I was noticing with this dancer that she's so she is so at home in front of the camera that she just blossoms in front of the camera. So it's not an easy thing to do, I think. It's glorious, yeah, glorious film. I wanted to also comment on Kelly Hargreaves' other film. What it feels like. And I think it's a very enigmatic film. I know that from the notes with the film that it has to do to a certain extent with some of the constrictions that women may have felt by being bound up with certain kinds of clothing and certain sorts of icons or what's the word, images that women would have historically been bound by. But to me, there was just this beauty. I just couldn't help but see such beauty. I think it was the camera up so close to the lace and the buttons falling down her back, and it was sensuous. It was incredibly sensuous, and that alongside Sameness Magnificence, to me, they're modern, and the women look edgy and modern. They don't look kind of glamorous in an old-fashioned way, but yet they embody this unbelievable level of beauty that I don't know if that's their intention, but I feel it very strongly.
Yeah, so extraordinarily beautiful. And it's interesting the what it feels like then is so much more close up. It's like this kind of micro world with all the lace and the buttons, whereas the other one it's kind of wide in these wide landscapes. There's so many textures in the what it feels like, isn't there? You can almost feel the lace in your hands, and you can hear the buttons sort of rattling, and you can see the physical body and the skin and the feet. The bare feet are so striking.
Beautiful shot. Yeah,
amazing, isn't it? It's I agree. I mean, I found it so beautiful, and to look, it is interesting to see the constriction of that corset and the tying of the ropes and all of that, because it does, you do feel that constriction, but all the time there is that real beauty of just the natural, like, and the very natural skin and the natural hair, and there's no frills. It's funny because it's lace, but it's all very organic and natural. Yes. Even though there's all of that there, it manages to do all of that in one piece, which is really extraordinary.
I think that's the enigma. Part of me feels that the dancer loves, while the dancer maybe, or the dance of the piece, the message might be about women have been bound, but part of me feels she loves that. Not the binding, but she loves the beauty of it, I feel. Or maybe that's just me. Could be me.
Yeah, I don't know. Or looks so, because it's so beautifully done. And even those pieces and how they're represented, it's all so aesthetically beautiful. Exactly. It's so well constructed, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. And I just wanted to reference then back to our earlier film, because these films interest me. They're kind of, they're in a way a slight companion to each other, in that in the first one, Mine, we have the man and he's claiming the landscape and the land and almost taking up the space in the land in what we might call a masculine archetype, but does it with incredible sensitivity as a sort of, not feminine, but... there's something about his movement and the way he is coming and going in and out of that landscape that has that balance of the male and the female. And then I feel that this piece, it's a very beautiful woman, but there's a tinge of the masculine about her. I think maybe the very short hair or the kind of questioning look, the way she observes herself in the mirror. And so I find that there's an interesting conundrum about these two films. And I also see them as kind of almost, you know, when you go to a gallery and you see a beautiful portrait. So it's just the head and, you know, it's just that. So it's not the big expanse. It's the small thing, but very, very beautifully done. Yeah, I really love those two films. Yeah. We have the anniversary as well to talk, reference to.
What an incredible film. Yeah. I don't know where to start with it. There's so much in it. It was just such an incredible setting, so stylish, so stylized, and so visceral as well. And I loved the opening with the older woman and the movement and how, you know, just her being totally herself. It was beautiful to watch, isn't it?
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah. I feel as, I suppose, as I'm getting older myself, I can relate to a lot of this film. I loved it. I found it visually very, very American, very Californian, lush, you know, this bright, sparkling sun. And I just loved the way she danced and showed her skin not being young anymore, yeah. But just relishing in, with such honesty in it, and beauty. I mean, I find tremendous beauty in this kind of woman because of her raw, unapologetic being in her body at this stage. And yes, it's all this kind of longing for and desire and longing and being rejected and everything and looking back at the earlier parts of her life. But I just loved these landscape, you know, this empty street again. We keep seeing these empty streets.
Yeah.
Where did they ever film them? Never anyone around.
It was an incredible setting, an incredible yes. choreography. I just loved the high school version with all the high school girls. And when yeah. when she first approaches them and one of them is moving and the others are all completely still in these amazing postures. It's so arresting. It's so interesting to look at. And then that incredible sequence where they do those different moves and come in and out of the, from behind the pillars yes. in that yeah. choreograph. I mean, that it's just so incredible to watch. And the music then changes with each scene and has different parts to match those different movements. Mm. It's utterly beguiling, I found, all of that. Like, I was just completely immersed in it and sucked into it. I found yeah. it really fascinating to watch.
Yes, me too. And I remember the day I watched that, I opened it up, you know, at some point, and I was just like, wow, what is this? You know, it's so different as well. Sometimes certain films come in that are just visually, they're very bright and very sparkly, and there's something, the energy is up in some way. And I find that very, I like it a lot. It's a great contrast to what sometimes we can be going down rabbit holes a lot of the time, but
yeah.
this piece is very up there.
Very
we both loved the male dancer at the yeah. at the traffic lights.
Amazing.
It was so great. Yeah.
I loved his, and I loved that he wasn't initially. He's kind of standing, and I love that, you see, that what's really great is that movement from the ordinary movement. Like, he's standing there with a bag of shopping or whatever, and then the oranges roll away. There's his shock. And then he goes into the move, you know, he goes into this dance movement. And I just love that, how he's
yeah.
ordinary movement. And then all of a sudden he's a dancer, and it's an extraordinary expression in his bodily. I just, you know, I was like, I want to yeah. see somebody dance like that at the traffic lights. Yeah.
Yeah. And don't we all feel that frustration in the traffic? I know, yeah, we feel the frustration in the traffic. And wouldn't it be great to just dance like that? it's a beautiful selection of films for the whole evening, I feel. And I just want to check into, we have quite a few comments have come in there. Kelly is saying, Yes, indeed. The no-frills approach, she talks about thanking us for seeing the beauty in the no-frills approach. Great. She says this is indeed her signature. Wonderful. So good to see that. They're a part of a series of character studies. Isn't that interesting? Yeah. Yes, and also the dancer and what it feels like on a gender journey. So interesting, because we were, we were picking up on some of that. Of course, the thing about the arts is that it's the interpretation is always so open, and what we as an artist intend to send out may never land. Maybe it's just something we feel, but it's great when there's a synchronicity there. So do you have any last words you'd like to say, Siobhán?
Well, I'm just very grateful for having had the opportunity to join and to get to comment and experience these films, and not having been familiar with the art. I found it very moving. I'm really, you know, impressed with just what people are doing. I suppose I feel like I've an interest now in this art form, which I wasn't really familiar with, which is great. And it's just extraordinary to yeah. see all these contrasts, everything, the landscape with the bodies, the music with the... all of it. It's incredible work that people are doing, and it's really inspiring. Yeah. So thank you so much for sharing with
Not
me, and really gratitude to everybody who sent in their work. Yeah.
I echo that 100%. Huge thanks to all the artists. And we will have another screening on Tuesday, same time, starting at the same time. And thank you so much, Siobhán. And it is a very contemporary art form. It really is our world coming through in these films. And I think that's what makes it in some ways so compelling. So big thanks to you, Siobhán. I'm sure we'll get you back again next year. There's more to be said, I'm sure.
My absolute pleasure.
Many thanks to all of our artists and thanks to the team once again. And we will say good night. Have a very good evening, Miss Ireland. We're at night time. I don't know where you are, wherever you are around the world, but we'll be back at the same time on Tuesday. And many thanks to you all.